Well, greetings to all you stray cats out there in YouTube land, and welcome to today's video in which we're going to start on what will be a very interesting project. I was sent this chassis by a viewer who had no use for it and thought that I might, and last night I was thinking of some constructive use for it. I thought about putting it into a small head cabinet or something like that, but I thought, nah, that's kind of boring. So here's what I came up with. What if I remove all of the components, including the little tube sockets, pots, jacks, everything from this chassis, and install them all in this crazy little metal cabinet that I picked up? This is a 6-volt power supply made by Mallory. It no longer works, but it's got some snazzy Dr. Frankenstein gauges on the front and a really nice dial here, and it just has a really nice look to it. So I was thinking to gut all of this. It's about 10 pounds here of hardware, including big transformer. I'll save it if it's still functional. Look at that for a selenium rectifier and a big filter cap, but pull all this out, build an aluminum chassis inside here, and install all of the components from the Airline Model 9002 amp into the chassis in this miniature cabinet. And I'm thinking, make both the gauges work, if they do work, use this, say, as the volume control, and down here this could be the on-off switch. Maybe put some crafty looking pilot light and maybe a tone knob. Okay, and I think if I can fit it all in here, we've got the louvers up here to let it cool and all. I think it ought to be a really snazzy looking little amp head. So if you agree, then by all means stay tuned and we'll get started on this. If you disagree and think I've completely lost my mind, then get back to your Russian pole dancer videos. Okay, so for the stalwart amp fiends, let's get started. Well, Jack, I can tell you're feeling very energetic and anxious to help me with this video. Okay, come on, you gonna help your old uncle with the video? Come on, buddy. Let's go get to work. No, I guess not. Okay, step one, let's pull out the 6X5 rectifier, the 6V6 output tube, and the 6AU6 preamp tube from the chassis. And then I'm going to make a wiring diagram for this. I can't find a schematic. And then remove the transformers, pots, and everything else from the chassis. Well, as if by magic, the aluminum chassis is now completely stripped, and we have a complete kit here to build an Airline Model 9002 in a much snazzier cabinet. If anybody really needs this chassis and control panel, if it's better than yours, let me know and I'll send it to you. Okay, now shortly disassemble the cabinet here of this Mallory power supply. Look at the massive transformer and rectifier. God, what a capacitor, huh? So I'm going to remove all of this so that I have essentially a bare cabinet. I'll leave the gauges in and maybe I'll be able to make them actually function. Okay, here's that power supply cabinet all emptied out and a whole lot lighter now. I saved the good parts like the Mallory dial plate and some switches, knobs, and other stuff. Then there's the bulky Dr. Frankenstein lab stuff that came out of it. The world's biggest selenium rectifier. Look at this transformer. Good grief. And a tiny little 10,000 microfarad filter cap. Wow. Well, a little more work, and now the cabinet is completely stripped inside and out. Okay, I cut out a nice stout piece of aluminum here to form the chassis, and I top riveted a piece of right angle aluminum along the rear of the cabinet wall to serve as a support for the chassis, just like a shelf support. Okay, I've cut and pop riveted brackets for both sides of the cabinet. So now the chassis can simply fit in here and support all sorts of weight. Alright, now I've installed the power transformer and output transformer on the chassis with the wires coming out down below. Next, I drill holes to either side of the output transformer for 4 ohm and 8 ohm speaker jacks. Then I machine the aluminum plate for the rectifier, 6V6, and preamp tube. Well, I've made some progress here. I put a nice brushed finish on the aluminum plate, and I've riveted in the 3 tube sockets and mounted the power transformer and output transformer. I'm pretty well on my way to getting it wired. You can see the filter caps, and still several more wires to go, and then of course I have to install the input and output jacks and the volume and tone controls, and also the pilot light. Okay, here's the front of the cabinet, and one hole in the front here didn't fit my plans, so I filled it and I'm going to block sand it. Also, then I'm going to drill 2 holes, one for an on-off switch, one for a pilot light, all in line with this pair of top holes here. And then after that's done, I'm going to paint the whole cabinet with kind of a bronze hammer tone paint. Okay, the hole is filled and leveled. I drilled the hole for the pilot light, for the on-off switch. That's for the fuse, the AC cord. This will be probably tone, and then these two will be the input jacks, and then up here will be the volume control. Okay, here's the rear of the cabinet with the 2 speaker jacks installed. Flip it around, you see they're in here. Now I'm going to wire them. Once I slip the chassis in, they'll be wired to the proper spot in the circuit. Okay, here's the front control panel, and I think it's turning out really nice. I had to use 2 new self-grounding input jacks. The original jacks from the amplifier were used at the rear of the cabinet to be speaker outlet jacks. This is a really cute little miniature old-timey pilot light. I used one of the graduated rings that a viewer sent me behind the tone control pot. This is the original amp on-off toggle, the original fuse holder. Also, you see up here I used the Mallory power supply plate, but here is the original amp volume control. Okay, so once I put the knobs on, this will look sort of like the original Mallory power supply, but will be I hope, good sounding little tube amplifier. I have to be real careful touching this. It's been 24 hours, most of it over 100 degrees, and the Rust-Oleum hammer tone paint still has not dried completely. I'm going to bet you a year from now it will not be dry. I've never seen a paint in my life that takes so long to dry, costs so much, and clogs so many nozzles. Here's an inside view of the components that I've attached to the control panel. The chassis is going to come right in here between the fuse and grommet for the power cord. I've cut some relief in the chassis to fit around the volume or tone control, and then it'll come down right between the 2 input jacks. Well, I guess I was naive to think that the gauges would work, and they don't, of course. So they're just going to be there for looks. My plan was, and I thought this was a good idea, to have this gauge show the voltage drop across the cathode bias resistor so that you'd always have an idea of what your plate current is. This one, the DC amps, I wasn't sure about. I might have come up with some idea for it. But it was missing its glass. There was no glass, and fortunately the gauge itself was not damaged. So I had the great pleasure of taking the gauge apart and then kind of crudely cutting a piece of glass that will fit inside of the bezel. So now I'm going to put it all back together and hopefully it will survive the process. Well, the DC ammeter survived the procedure. Now it has a nice new glass. The voltmeter, I cleaned it up a little bit, and now they're ready to install back into that front panel of the little amp cabinet. Okay, here's the front panel all assembled. I came up with the ultimate Dr. Frankenstein knob here from some old radio or something over the last 50 years, the parts that I've accumulated. I machined it to fit the volume control pot from the airline amp. And so now we're ready to start installing the chassis and wiring it up to this faceplate. All the components attached to the front panel have now been wired. This is going to be for the pilot light, the two input jacks, volume control, tone control. There's the pilot light right there, and this will be for the AC to come up here to the switch and the fuse, and that's where the three-wire power cord will enter. And this is going to carry the signal from the input jacks to the grid of the first preamp tube. And also, it should be noted, because of the distances between here and the circuit and the presence of AC, all of the signal-carrying wires are shielded, and the shields are grounded at one end. Well, the wiring is finished, I believe. This is where the input will come from the shielded cable connected to the front panel with the volume and tone controls through this capacitor to the grid of the 6AU6 preamp tube. From there, it will pass through this coupling capacitor to the 6V6, which is cathode biased and bypassed. Here is the 6X5 rectifier tube and the entire power supply isolated from the preamp tube. Filter capacitors up here. This is where the AC will connect. It will come in here and then go up through the fuse and switch and come back to this point. And this is also where the pilot light will connect. You notice I have created a virtual center tap here on the filament 6-volt input so that it will reduce hum. There is no center tap for the 6-volt winding in this transformer. This is some sort of adjustable capacitor of very low value. I have no idea exactly what purpose it serves, but I'll find out by once I get the amp running. I'll adjust it and see if it has any effect at all. I'm starting to assemble this little jewel, and as you can see here, the output transformer is wired to the 8 ohm and 4 ohm output jacks for the speakers. I have the tubes in place, and the chassis is secured to the cabinet by screws on either side. And this is the inlet that makes room for the rear of the tone control when the control panel is put into place. Now, this design presents some rather unusual problems for assembly, because once you put in that front panel, everything in here is going to be sealed. You can't do any wire routing or soldering or anything else on top. So I put holes in the chassis so that when I start to put the front panel in, I'm going to route the AC wires here, the signal input here, and over here will be for the pilot light. Then I can go underneath, flip the whole thing over, and solder them into place. Now you'll see what I was talking about. Here's the front starting to be installed, and then you look inside and you see the pilot light, signal wire, and the AC wires entering those holes that I've drilled in the chassis surface so they can be soldered in underneath. Okay, I put in a couple screws on each side to hold it together so I can now flip it over and do the finished soldering on the bottom. I'm going to leave some slack in the wire so that if this ever needs to be taken apart, undo the screws, and this will be able to pull out a ways before you run out of slack. Here we are underneath the chassis with the final wiring. This is the AC cord coming in with the ground right to where the filter caps ground. And the hot wire going through the fuse and switch before it goes to the transformer. Over here is the pilot light to the 6-volt filaments. And finally, we have the signal coming in here through this capacitor and to the grid of the 6AU6. And as is so sadly typical of Rust-Oleum paint, there were still some areas here that were soft enough to stick to the cloth while the unit was upside down for the wiring. An interesting problem arose while I was trying to bias this amp. If you notice here, I'm monitoring the voltage drop across the cathode biasing resistor. And you see it's stabilized here at about 9.62. Well, the way this circuit was originally created, for some reason there was no resistor between the grid and ground. And as you hopefully know from previous videos, that resistor is essential to establish the grid bias in the tube. We cathode bias with this resistor, but the grid really must be biased also. And without that resistor to ground, there really is no grid bias. So now watch what the plate current does the minute I remove that resistor. Look at the plate current rising. It's going up through the roof. I'm going to turn off the amp to prevent any harm. But if you get ever a output tube or tubes that will not stabilize on its plate current, and the plate current just keeps increasing without stopping, then be sure you check the condition and value of the resistor between the grid and ground. Notice that when I restore that grid to ground resistor from the 6V6, the plate current stabilizes, and this is a value indicative of about 35 milliamps, which gives a plate dissipation of around 10 or 10 and a half watts, which is absolutely ideal. Another cause of runaway plate current is a leaky coupling capacitor, because if it allows the positive DC to come from the plate of the 6AU6 through the capacitor to the grid of the 6V6, it will increasingly charge the grid positive, which will stimulate all sorts of electron flow through the tube and cause the 6V6's plate current to increase until the tube self-destructs. And so I replaced the original 0.02 at 600 Sangamo coupling cap with a brand new 0.02 microfarad coupling cap. And while I was at it, I thought, oh, what the heck, and I replaced all of the Sangamos with new capacitors. Okay, let's see if we can coax some decent sound out of this little jewel. I'll start off at kind of a moderate volume so that we can get some clean tone. Now let's turn the volume up a little so we can get some breakup. Okay, now let's crank it wide open and just see just how nasty it can get. Thank you. let's talk about what we've seen and heard here. First off, this little amp circuit is very limited because this 6AU6 is not a real dynamic preamp tube. You could change the tube socket and put in a 12AX7, then you'd have essentially a Fender Champ. You'd also need to beef up that microscopic output transformer so you could get a little more bass and a little fuller tone. But as it stands, you get a reasonable volume and clean tones. And then when you crank it up, you get some pretty fierce distortion at very moderate volume, really. This would be a great little practice amp. And if you wanted to go ahead and crank it up and do your Van Halen imitations and all, I don't think you'd be disturbing the neighbors too much. So that's about it for this video, in which you've taken the mighty Mallory filtered rectified power supply and turned it into a pretty decent little guitar amplifier. Well, I hope you enjoyed the video. I thought there were a couple worthwhile learning moments there during the surgery. And if you did enjoy it, please consider subscribing and also becoming a patron of our channel by joining at Patreon or sending a PayPal donation. We really appreciate it. It keeps us on the air and it keeps us advertising free. And to all of you who have already subscribed and donated, Jack and I want to extend our heartfelt thanks. And as a little celebration of the conclusion of the video, let's go for a brief musical drone flight that I hope you enjoy, and that you will join Jack and me for our future videos. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next time.